Today I'm working with accordion books, but not just any old accordion books. The ones I'm playing with are very long with lots of panels to create on. I've always found the biggest shortcoming of most accordion books is the limited overall length, but I've solved that problem and you're going to see just how much fun these long books are. I really enjoy creating accordion books. I love the format, the way they fold into a compact book, but then they expand to reveal all of the pages and the content. Most of mine tend to be no longer than 24 inches because that's the longest side of an 18 by 24 paper pad. You can buy those big Strathmore pads, and we have them in the watercolor version, and they're what I use for a lot of things, and up until now, they're what I've been using to make my accordion books. The problem is that you can only get a piece that's 24 inches long unless you piece it. And sometimes you get, you know, you can do that, which is what I've done here. You can see that this is a longer one, but you can get varying results. Like, this is not a very good join, and I'm not a perfectionist, you know that, but this really does not look that great, and it does bother me. Sometimes it works better than others, but after thinking about this for a long time, I finally devised a solution. We're going to make them ourselves. We're going to have nice, big, nice, long format accordion books. We're making them out of Strathmore's lovely 140-pound cold-press watercolor paper, and we can make them as long as 65 or 70 inches, which means lots of pages, lots of panels, and you can make some really nice big format books. So, for example, this is an accordion book that features our butterflies from a couple of the butterfly collage sheets and quotes about butterflies that I've also made into a collage sheet, and you can see that I've got multiple panels. Now, this measures 5 inches tall by 7 inches wide, and there's there's 5 panels on this. So this one happens to be 35 inches long. I cut it down a little bit. This one is a 5x5 book, and this features images from the Odd Fellows collage sheet. This one is a lot longer. I want to say that this has 10 panels, so this is 50 inches long, and you can see that you can get a lot of content on here. Now, the Odd Fellows are kind of fun, funky images. You see this one here. You can make this. You don't necessarily have to make it with a dark background if you don't choose to, and we'll talk about that a little bit further on. And then we come to this. Now, this is an accordion book. This is facing you at this point. This measures 8 inches wide by 10 inches tall, and I want to say there are 8 panels in here, so it measures 65 inches when it's fully opened. And I'm actually treating this one like an art journal. So rather than an accordion book like this that features the same movement of color and pattern across all of the pages of the book, I'm choosing to treat this more like an art journal, and you can see that I've done a little bit here, which is entirely different than what's going on here, and then I have all of these other pages that I can do the same thing with. I can start changing things out. Now, I can also use the back of these, so that gives me double the amount of pages if I want to go there. What's really nice with these large format books is that you have the opportunity to tell a much bigger story if you want to. The one that I'm currently working on, and let me show you what's going on. First of all, this is a boo-boo, and I want to talk to you about that. What I did was place this the wrong way, for starters. All right, what I did was I started by coloring these. This is, again, the 8x10 that has 8 panels. And I started coloring every other one of the panels. This is the De La Rowney F&W pearlescent ink that I put a wash on, and I'm going to show you how to do that. This was the first page. It was like this. Or like this, I forget how it was, but somehow I got some smudge in this corner and I tried to clean it up and it actually made it worse. I should have just left it alone. So I ended up cutting it off, and this book is going to have 7 panels. But you'll see, if I ever get here, what I'm going to do now is I'm going to use pink and green, and the pink will be the first color. I'm going to show you how to do this. And then they're going to alternate, and I've got these really cool thistle flowers, again from another collage sheet. And you can see that I've written some quotes about flowers here. And I'm going to use these images all across the various pages in this book. So what I want to do is show you how I put the color on here. And that's going to start with, I've got just a container of clean water on the side. This is my big 1-inch mop brush. That is a Princeton brush. And I'm going to use some of the De La Rowney F&W pearlescent ink. And I'm going to put pink on every other page. So what I'm going to do is start by putting some of this out on my nonstick craft sheet. Now, this was a color I mixed, so I'm not going to be able to go back and mix it again, but I did all the pages I needed to with it, and that worked out just fine. So I'm going to take my mop brush, and it's pretty wet. You can see how much water there is, and if I touch that, it kind of dribbles off. What I want to do is put a wash of water on this page that's the exact shape of how I want the color to be. By doing this, it allows me to control, once I put the color on, the water kind of helps keep the color in place. It will only run past the edge if you push on it really, really hard. So I'm setting up the borders of this page, and I'm kind of tilting my head so I can see the reflection in the light. I'm setting up the borders of this page with the water before I even get the color on it. So now what I'm going to do is take some more water, and I'm going to thin out this, and I already can tell I've thinned it out too much. I need to put some more color on here. You need to remember to shake these really well. The pigment is going to settle on the bottom, and you really have to move it to get it shook and all suspended in the liquid. So just bear that in mind. But there's a nice range of colors in this line that have a lovely pearlescent glow that can be in your face, or if you thin it down like I am, it can be quite subtle. So now that I've got some color on here, I'm going to start laying it down. Now, I'm not going to deliberately push past the border that I've already put in place because I don't feel like I need to make this any bigger, but I could if I needed to. That's always an option. So I'm choosing to not lay this down in a really heavy amount. I've thinned it with water, and it's getting thinned a little bit further as I put it on the page because there's already water here. And you can see that my edges are kind of swoopy, they're not real defined, and I'm okay with that. I don't feel like these have to be perfect. In fact, I have a little bump right here that happened by accident, and I'm actually going to leave that in. I think it provides some really fun edges, and again, I can kind of write some quotes around this. So all I need to do now is just take my heated tool and dry this off, and then I can move on. And I want to show you a little bit about the images, but then I can move on and just finish this. And this is a very simple but really effective accordion book. With the background dry, I can choose which image I want to put on this page. Now, there are only 4 available, so I know I'm going to have to repeat them. It's just a question of preference as to which ones I do repeat. Now, admittedly, cutting these out can be a little bit picky, especially this business right here, and certainly all of this business on the first one was. Sorry, would be helpful if you could see that. But I think it's worth it because I think this makes a really nice book, and if you want to customize this to someone's preferences in terms of quotes or poetry about flowers or gardens, you can certainly do that, and it makes a really, really nice book. So you've got to get yourself some good scissors. I like to use small 4-inch scissors like this, and it's just a matter of making your way around this. Now, somebody wrote me not that long ago and asked, what do I do on the really fine details? Antenna on butterflies and moths and those kinds of things, and mostly what I do is I just leave a white border like you've seen me do right here, and obviously I need to trim this along the top. But I don't think that border in any way distracts from the image itself, and it allows you to have a piece that's a little bit sturdier. So it's just a question of continuing to cut this out, and then I can go ahead and glue this in place, and then I can do the same thing for the rest of the pages in here. Now obviously, you can see that I've outlined this. So in order to do that, it's pretty straightforward. I'm just going to use a pit pen in black. This one happens to be a fine tip. You could use the S for the super fine. I think either would work okay for this. And really, it's just a matter of going ahead and outlining the edge of this. And I don't try to make it perfect. There's some purple paint I managed to get on there. I just try to go along and mostly follow the outline. You can vary the weight of the lines. You can make them a little bit heavier in spots if you want, kind of like I'm doing here, and then you can lighten up and make them a little bit more sketchy. But that really is the extent of it. This, as I said, I think makes a really nice book. Well, where's the other page? Here it is. And I think that it allows you the opportunity to get creative without having to spend hours and hours and hours putting together a project like this. So let's turn our attention to the Oddfellows collage sheet for a second. That was the one I mentioned in the last segment. Now this one is printed in black and white, so it allows you the opportunity to come in and to color this to suit your book, whatever you've done. In my original, which is right here, you can see that my characters are all dressed in greens and oranges and yellows and blues. This one isn't dressed so much as it's a bug with really googly eyes, but you get the drift. And so I've been consistent with that throughout all of the images in here. I think it helps make this book very cohesive. I mean, the background does that anyway, but having the characters all dressed in the same colors really helps pull that together as well. So what I do, this is, when we print our collage sheets, they're printed on paper that has 24% cotton rag in it, so it accepts the inks or paint or whatever you want to do beautifully without any difficulty. You can see that I've already got one started here. Now I know when I demo how to do the background for that accordion book, I'm going to just show you on a piece of paper because it's too hard for me to capture all of an accordion book in the frame, so it's just easier to work on a piece of watercolor paper like this. And I've already chosen some colors. I know I'm going to go with, this is the Dina Wakely line, this is Blackberry Violet. I'm going to use Night as my dark. I'm going to use some turquoise as my highlight color, and I might bring in some silver too. I haven't really made up my mind. So the colors I've chose are kind of in that family and out, but what I've done is picked some, and I'm going to be consistent when I color my figures for this book. And so I've got some colors here. I've got five colors. These are the Tim Holtz detail water brushes. This one has just water in it. I'm going to show you what I do with that in a second, but really this is very, very straightforward. I know I want to use, let's try this purple on the hair and see how this looks. But the nice thing is with this really fine tip, it allows me to be able to get in there and do all of these fine areas without going too far outside the lines. Now, if you're coloring right, excuse me, if you're cutting right on the lines, then it doesn't matter if you go outside a little bit. But as you get down here toward the tip of these, you're probably going to need some white space. I'll leave some around there as you cut, which I alluded to a moment ago. And having this really fine tip makes it easy. So you can see it's very straightforward, and I like to pick up colors and repeat them. So I used Stream on this line here on her legs. So I'm just going to fill in her stockings here with some Stream. Again, that kind of helps pull it all together. Her sleeves are that color. Now on her face, what I've done is I've used, this is the Adirondack color Sunset Orange. And I've taken some and put it out on my nonstick craft sheet. And then I'm using a water brush that's just filled with plain water from the tap. And I'm going to thin this out and lighten it so that I get a much lighter version. And I can touch it to see what that looks like. If I think that that's a little bit too dark, I can just squeeze some more water out to the tip. And now I'm just going to paint her face. I've already done her hands and her arms where her flesh is showing outside the sleeves. But as far as I'm concerned, they can be any color. The ones on my other sample, they have a greenish tinge skin, which you can't see there, but you can see here. In fact, here's that same figure, and she's greenish. You can, these are fantasy creatures. You can do anything that you want with them. So that would be the process. I would go ahead and I would get these colored and cut out. And what I'll do now is show you how I apply the color, the background color, in this style here. We're going to scrape it on using just a plastic scraper. It's very loose, very haphazard, but it creates a really effective background. As I showed you a moment ago, I have Dina Wakely's Blackberry Violet already applied to this piece of 140-pound watercolor paper. That's going to be the base, and we're eventually going to work our way up to something that looks like this, albeit in different colors. Now, before I forget, I might have said this, but I don't remember. This journal is 5x5, or this accordion book is 5x5, and there are, I want to say there are 10 panels on here. Now, you could use these characters on a 5x5, which is what this is, or you could use it on a 6x6, and this again has 10 panels. So our initial offering of these books is going to be 5x5 by 10 panels, 6x6 by 10 panels. We'll have a 5x7 that has 8 panels. That's what, whoops, this book was done on. And then we'll have that 8x10x8 panels so that you can do a larger version if you want. All right, so let's get back to how to do this background. Let's get this other stuff out of the way. So the next thing I want to do is bring in Night. I want to leave some of the white showing through, and I want to leave some of the Blackberry Violet showing through because they're going to be my accent colors, but I do want to put quite a coat of Night on there. So I'm just going to put some initially here on my, well, apparently my left hand is not working. I'm going to put some here on my, this is our plastic scraper spreader, and I'm just going to start applying this color. And you can see, now I'm not going to get any mixing because the paint is dry and it's permanent when it is dry, but you can see how I can get as much or as little coverage as I want. I'm just going to squeeze some of this out over here on the side and pick it up this way. So now I've got, again, some more on my plastic scraper, and I'm just going to start putting this on here. Again, keeping in mind that I want to let some of that Blackberry Violet and some of the white peep through. So this really is the process. You're going to go ahead and cover most of the Blackberry Violet, but you are going to leave that the other colors to show through. Now, it really depends on how much of these other colors you want to show through. I'm pretty good with this. I might add just a little bit more, but I am going to come back with the turquoise and I'm going to add some of that on as well, but I'm going to do that with my fingers and I'm going to do that after the fact. So before I can do anything else, I need to dry this and then I'll come back and we'll go with the next step, which is I'm going to start putting white on here. With the color Night dry, I can come back now and start adding my white. So this time I'm going to put the color right on here. Even though these are really opaque paints, it's going to take a fair amount and it might take more than one coat to effectively go ahead and cover up this as much as I know that I'm going to want to. So it's just a question of, again, kind of applying the white haphazardly, leaving areas open as you choose, and if you want to come back and add some more Night, I know that you can, because I did this myself when I was working on my piece. I went back and forth a little bit till I was really satisfied with how the colors look. Now again, you're going to work on a long accordion book, so you're going to have these pages running one into another, and you're going to get a little bit of a different look than I am here on this one piece. But you can see the colors showing through, which I really like. And you can, again, do as much of this or as little as you want. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to play with this a little bit. I might come back and put some more Night on. And then once I get this all dry, I'll come back and show you what I like to do next, which is I'm going to add that accent color. In this case, it's going to be the turquoise. These layers are dry enough now that I'm going to come back and use turquoise as my accent color. Now you can see I've done a little bit already. I'm not going to do too much because I want to show you the next thing I'm going to do with turquoise. But when I do this, I just put a little bit on my finger and I go ahead and I spread it around. And ordinarily I probably wouldn't put it quite this close, but I'm just trying to get some on here so you can see. That's really all there is to this. Now you'll also notice that my white has kind of turned purple. That's because though the Dina Wakely paints are permanent when they're dry, they're just dry to the touch. They really aren't dry, they aren't cured, and so there's definitely some bleeding going on. If I really wanted this to be super white, I would come back, leave this to sit for a good, you know, 6 to 8 to 10 hours. I'd leave it overnight and then work on it the next day, and then I can put some white on here and it's going to stay a lot more white than what I'm getting. But again, for my purposes, this is fine. So the next thing I want to do is I'm going to use our Loris Ipsum stencil and I'm going to put some text on here with the turquoise. So let me put this here where you can see it. That's going to be more than enough. And I just want to put some text on here. Now on this stencil there are three sizes. I'm choosing to use this one only because my version of the accordion book is 5x5 and that worked. On something this big you could get away, this is a 9x12 piece of watercolor paper, you could certainly get away with using the large ones. I'm going to use the middle ones here just so that you can see it. And I'm going to pick up an ink blending tool. This has got some old paint on it, but it's dry so it doesn't make any difference. I reuse these all of the time. All right, so let's go ahead and just put this down there. You know what? That's not going to work. Let me grab one that's a little bit better color, swap this off, and see if we can make this work properly. All right, so again, I'm going to come in here, and I'm going to lay down some text using my accent color, which is the turquoise, and I would do this in various places. You don't have to use the same letters over and over so that you get a nice variety. And really, that's all there is. So what I am going to do, again, is dry this because I want to come back with white, and I can't really do that on top of these words that are wet with the turquoise, or I'm going to get some smearing and some color bleed, which I really don't want for this next step. So let me go ahead, get this dry, and then I'll come back and I'll show you. We're going to talk about white circles using our dotted grid stencil, and then we're going to use a big Picket template, and this is one of those that comes in all shapes and sizes, and that's how I got those really big white dots on my book. One thing you'll notice if you look at my sample accordion book is that all of the figures are on one of these big white dots, and you can see that the dots are actually different sizes. I kind of kept in mind what size the character was I was going to put on that dot, and I also tried to vary them just because it makes it a little bit more interesting. I varied the size as well as the placement. So again, I'm working on a piece of paper, you're going to work on a nice long accordion book, but to give you an idea of what I did, this is that Picket template I mentioned a moment ago. This is called their giant circles, and it has this really big circle on here that I want to say is it's under paint, it's a little hard to read. It looks like it's 3.5 inches. So you can vary your size again depending on what size the figures are. On the 5x5 book, you can use as much as this 3.5 inch one. It works just fine if you want to use that for one of the larger ones. Again, I'm going to turn to Dina Wakely's white paint. I'm going to put a little bit out on my surface here. I'm not going to do all of these. I just want to do enough so that you get a sense of how I accomplished what I did. So I'm going to tuck this down here on the side because it's going to leave me some room to do some other things. And I'm just going to pick up a whole blob of paint here, and I'm going to smear this in this circle with my finger. And in fact, that probably wasn't enough paint. I might just be able to spread it out, but I'm going to have to put some more out anyway because I want to show you what I'm going to do with our dotted grid. Now again, this might change color because what's underneath is not really dry, but you understand what I'm doing. So that's one way to get your circles on there. You use this template, you pick and choose whatever you want. The other thing that you can do, and that I did, is to use our dotted grid stencil, and I need to get one of the mini ink blending tools with either a white, previously used white, or a clean pad. This one's a clean pad because I don't want to change the color. So what I'm going to do, again, let me bring in my book so that you can see for reference. I've used two sizes, or both sizes, of the dots from our dotted grid stencil, and I've kind of placed them randomly in various places on here. So that's all you have to do. Just pick your spots and put down some color. I like to use the mini blending tool for this. I get really good results. And I generally like to keep my numbers odd. Now, you can kind of put your fingers over this so that you don't get ink, or excuse me, you don't get paint coming through in one of the holes and you don't change that around, or you can. It really doesn't make any difference. So again, same process. If I wanted to do three big ones here, I certainly could do that. And this is all you have to do. You just pick and choose, you place your circles however you want them. Again, you have to let them dry before you move on to the next step, but that's really easy too. So let me just kind of summarize the last of what's left that I need to explain to you to do this particular accordion book. I used someplace here. I used, this is Dina Wakely's black heavy body paint with the fine line applicator. I use that, it's a little hard to see because I went over it with stickles, but I just loosely went around all of the circles with that. I put some dots here with my Sharpie water-based markers. You can see that I put some circles around here. I used a cap or a bottle bottom to get around here. I've used lots of dots. Really, you can do whatever you want to accomplish whatever you're looking to do. I used white to put dots in various places, and it really is that simple. The more little dots that you add, the more interesting things get. Now, the one thing that I did forget to mention, this is the De La Rani, the F&W pearlescent ink that we talked about quite a few minutes ago where I did that page with it. This time I used, let me grab it, I use, well, this is not the one I normally use, but this is the first one I could put my hand on. This is a fan brush. You're going to thin it with some water and tap it on like this, and that's how you get spatters. And it's just a question of, I think the more little bitty details you add, the more interesting things get. So the speckles from all of the spattering, you get dots that you create with the black and the white markers. I'm on a real black and white kick lately. I think it adds a really interesting graphic effect to things. The last thing I want to show you is how I added the background to that butterfly accordion book. I used distressed paints, I used a lot of water and my fingers, and I want to show you that next. The technique I used for the background here that creates this really soft, delicate colors is really quite easy. It's distressed paint that I apply with my fingers. You work on wet, you put some more wet on it, and everything just flows beautifully. I'm going to show you how to do this, but instead of showing you on an accordion book that looks like that one with the butterflies, I want to use this, as I said, like an art journal. And so what I'm going to do is make each of the panels a different background, and I thought it would be a good idea to show you on this panel right here. It's enough room for you to see the process and how I actually go ahead and do it. It really doesn't make any difference what I'm working on. The process remains the same. So I have some distressed paint and I'm shaking it. For this particular colorway, I have cracked pistachio, twisted citron, peacock feathers, and tumbled glass. So what I'm going to do is let's slide this back toward me and put some of each of these colors out. Now what you can see that what I've done here is I've gone ahead and taped this previous page off with blue painter's tape, a nice wide piece. Because I'm working with my fingers, it would be pretty easy to keep this where it doesn't belong, or keep it from where it doesn't belong, but I don't want to take any chances. I don't want to slip because I really like the way this looks, and it doesn't, you know, have blues and greens in it, so I don't want to add any. So I'm going to put some of the paint out. I really love this Twisted Citron color. It's such a nice, bright green. All right, get a little cracked pistachio going. You can see that this doesn't take a ton of paint. We're going to water this down. Now, I'm not going to put a lot of peacock feathers out because it's a pretty deep color, and I just want to use it as an accent. So now what I'm going to do, and by the way, I put painter's tape on the back side here too. I just want to protect this edge, and then I've got a piece of paper in here so that I can keep what's underneath clean. I'm going to come in, if I can find my spray bottle, and I'm going to mist some water on here. And then I'm going to spread it around with my fingers. It doesn't need to be sopping wet, but I do want enough water on here so that the paint will move. That's not going to be quite enough. All right, so now that I've got some water on there, I'm going to start picking up paint. And typically I would start with the lightest colors, and you can see how the color just flows. Now, obviously, tumble glass is not a super dark color, but you can see how readily that color just spreads and moves and becomes very light, almost watercolor-like. It takes on that very soft look, which I really like. So I'm just going to spread some of this. Now, some of the tumbled glass, thank you, I could not get that word out, is going to disappear because it's so light, but I do like to get some on there to begin with. And then I'm going to jump next into, I think I'll pick some of the cracked pistachio. Twisted Citron is really my favorite, but it has the ability to take over if you let it because it's such a bright color. Now this needs, I'm going to put some water here so I can put some on my finger. Again, I want to kind of be judicious how much I get close to this edge. So I can just go ahead and spread some of that, get some here. Again, I need some more water. Let's do it this way. It's easy enough to pick it up with my fingers. This corner down here has gotten a little dry. So again, with some more of the cracked pistachio, I'll come and I'll spread it along here, and I can already see that this is dry here, so I'm going to put some more. And now I'm going to pick up some Twisted Citron. Again, such a fun color. So pretty, and it just reminds me of a very lively color, very spring-like. Now, these are all colors that are not complementary. They are near one another on the color wheel. Well, that was a little bit too much Twisted Citron, I think. So they're going to blend without any difficulty. They're not going to be muddy if I'm really careful. I mean, certainly I could make these look a little bit yucky if I wasn't careful, but it's pretty hard to do when you work with colors that are near one another like this on the color wheel. So it's just a question of coming along and adding as much or as little of these colors as you really want. Now again, peacock feathers is pretty dark, so I want to be careful that I don't use too much of it. If I think that this needs more water, I can certainly come and add it. Again, I brought in a little bit of Twisted Citron there. I can come and add some of the peacock feathers just for a little darker accent. I'm going to come back to the Twisted Citron because I like it so much. And this is really all you do. I mean, you can play with this as much as you want, but I would advise you not to overwork it. It will start to look yucky. That's a very technical term. It will start to look yucky if you overwork it. But I think that this is fine. I don't think this needs to go any further. I might put a little bit of Twisted Citron just here along the edge, just for some continuity to kind of pull the colors in together. And then I might just call this done and leave it be, because as I said, it's going to look yucky if I overwork it. So, you know, we've talked about lots of different background techniques today, various things that you can try. Before I finish, let me show you the collage sheets that are these butterflies. Let's just pick this up, slide it out of the way, and I'm going to avoid that paint. So there are two that have enough green and blue butterflies so you have enough to work even on a 10-page panel, which the 5x5 and the 6x6 accordion books are there. There's more than enough. You can leave out these orange ones if you want to stick with the cool colors. And then we have this collage sheet that's going to be full of all kinds of quotes that are related to butterflies in a bunch of different fonts, so you kind of get that really interesting overall look. So we're going to have these, as I said earlier, available in 4 sizes. We'll have the 5x5, we'll have a 6x6, both with 10 panels. Someplace here it is the butterfly. This is going to be a 5x7, and I want to say that this is going to have 6 or 8 panels. what do my notes say? It's going to have 8 panels, and then we'll have that 8x10 that you just saw me working on, large format that you can do all kinds of great things with.